welcome to the KC and PC Fantasy Football Podcast. I am the KC, I'm working the X's and O's, and he's PC working the ones and zeros. It's week three of the fantasy football season, last week for division games in the Gangster for Life League. Hopefully you're 2-0 and dominating, or maybe you're 0-2, maybe you're 1-1, but this last week of division games is important, so aim for the win, as you usually should. Today we're going to be talking about one of the most controversial topics in the NFL right now and how it affects fantasy football.
What are we talking about? The nickname of the Washington Redskins? Domestic violence? CTE?
Okay, yeah, maybe it's a few steps below those on the controversial ladder. I'm actually talking about pass interference.
Jeez, you got me worked up for next to nothing. Guess I'll have to praise Dan Snyder and diss the Native American community some other day.
Pass interference. It was brought up as a topic of discussion in the NFL this spring. Some kind of suggested that NFL change pass interference from a spot foul to a penalty of 15 yards like college does. It never really got a chance to even be debated, though. But it did get me thinking, you know, what should we do with the current rule when it comes to fantasy? If pass interference is called right now in a game this season, nothing happens other than moving the ball closer to the end zone.
Don't forget about DBs throwing their hands in the air and complaining about how offenses get all the love.
Yeah, that too. But should wide receivers and maybe even quarterbacks get some yards or points for drawing that call? If so, I came up with a few options if, you know, we're wanting to give out points for that. So one, wide receivers and quarterbacks get the exact yardage of the penalty. So I see the merit of this idea, but I'm not a huge fan because a lot of times it's doubtful that the wide receiver would have even caught the ball. Usually, they can go sailing over their heads and you don't want to give out points for that. Option two, they get 12 yards added to their stats. So why 12? Well, it's because it's an instant point for wide receivers and essentially half a point for quarterbacks. It's a nice small bump and kind of takes care of the lost yardage issue. And then option three, this is my personal favorite, both quarterback and wide receiver get 2 points, but no yards are added to their totals. It's like a converted two-point conversion, and since the catch wasn't completed for actual yards, none are given. So what do you think, PC?
Sorry, I wasn't listening. I was on Reddit, seeing what other racist names people call Native Americans.
And what do our listeners think? Let me know. What do you think about pass interference? If anything should actually be changed about it, or if this is just some pipe dream. We just wanted to take a moment to thank one of our sponsors, Caveman Cosmetics. Newsflash, boys, it's not the Stone Age anymore. Men wear makeup. I know what you're thinking. Not me, not in 1,000 years. But guess what? The time has come to stop looking like a Neanderthal and start looking like a caveman. Caveman Cosmetics offers a full line of male beauty products for only the most testosterone-fueled hombres. You know, those guys who aren't afraid to spear a woolly mammoth and look great doing it. Lipstick, eyeshadow, blush, mascara. Caveman Cosmetics carries it all, and it's all meticulously handcrafted from manly ingredients like leather, whiskey, dinosaur eggs, and Chuck Norris's beard trimmings. Don't worry if you lose your division bet, because while they say worst in the division, we say best looking dude at the draft. So man up and wear this makeup. Caveman Cosmetics. Welcome back to the KC and PC Fantasy Football Podcast. It's guest time here, so I want to welcome to the program a man who makes George Costanza look like George Clooney, Andrew Fastle. Welcome. How's it going, sir?
Good, good. It's a wonderful day outside. The sun is shining, and I love it.
Great, great. So I'm just going to ask you a few questions here, get your takes on both the members of the Fantasy Football League we're in and some questions about the NFL as well. So I'll start you out here with an easy one. What position do you think you'd play if you were in the NFL?
Well, I probably want to be a long snapper. You'd get to be on the team. You get to call yourself an NFL football player. You get about $1 million, and you only have to play, I don't know, six, seven plays throughout a game. That sounds like a pretty easy life, and I think I could do that.
And you've had some experience, have you not?
I did have some experience. It was real easy as long as you didn't fuck up.
Fair enough. All right. Here's a question for you now about which of these terms would you say your significant other is your go-to romancing move? So if we ask Amanda, which of these is your go-to romancing move? Would it be the naked bootleg, the flea flicker, the button hook, the end around, fumble rooski, QB sneak, trick play, or touchback?
I would, of course, want to do the naked bootleg because she really likes the element of surprise, and if I can already be naked, then we're good to go.
All right. Okay, and our next question here, how about this? This is a kind of an interesting one. How much money would you have to be paid to let Von Miller blindside sack you? You have full pads on, but Von Miller's just going to come at you and wreck your life.
Well, since he's an Aggie, and I think he's pretty damn cool, he looks pretty fly when he wears his big old glasses, probably do it for about $1.
A dollar. You're going to... Just a dollar.
Dollar.
You're fine
then,
getting...
Then I can say that I got blindsided by Von Miller and then he handed me a single dollar bill. Actually, better yet, make it a $2 bill.
Oh, I like it. Those are very rare.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what do you think are the best and worst jerseys in the NFL? Which teams do you like looking at, or which teams are just have gross uniforms?
Well, the Steelers, whenever they look like bumblebees... That is just ridiculous. I'm a little bit partial to the good old Vikings. I think purple looks pretty good on some of the purple people eaters. Now the one thing that I am a little secret, kind of like the Jacksonville Jaguars helmet. That one, I don't know what it is, but I like that one.
All right, I can see it. And then the last question here we have for you is, when playing against quarterbacks in fantasy football, if you're playing against a quarterback who's throwing to your wide receivers and tight end, so you have the wide receiver and the tight end, your opponent has a quarterback, what do you do? Do you hesitate about starting those guys at all?
I don't usually hesitate because if it's a go-to receiver for that quarterback, then I know that he's going to be looking that way. So hopefully my wide receiver will put up a great day. If it's a bad day for him, hopefully the quarterback has a bad day as well. But, I'll go outside, do a little bit of a rain dance or something, and hope that all my other players pull through and put up about 40 points each.
There you go. Oh, and then I guess I forgot to ask this, but what are your predictions for the Cowboys this year? Record-wise, are they going to the playoffs? Are they missing out? What are you seeing? Super Bowl?
Oh, I mean, no, not anywhere close. I mean, they'll win the Super Bowl in off-season talking points, but yes. Not the actual Super Bowl. I'd probably say they're going back to about an 8-8 team. I mean, they're going to have probably a hard schedule and got some injuries, and I don't think they will. They're just not clicking right now.
Okay, fair enough. Well, Andrew, thank you so much for joining us on the program. We wish you best of luck in the fantasy football season, except against me, of course. I hope you lose.
I hope you lose every single one of your games as well.
Thanks
for having me.
Well, since we've kind of been talking about some rules earlier in the podcast, I wanted to use this segment to talk about some obscure NFL rules, the ones you don't really hear about all that often or, don't really come into play too much. And I have three of them that I wanted to talk about that are kind of neat. The first one is the fair catch field goal. So a team can call for a fair catch on a kickoff or punt and then immediately take a practically undefended field goal attempt from the spot of the catch. Yeah, that's right. The defense can't try to block the field goal. They have to line up 10 yards behind the ball. So there's no one standing there, you know, waving their arms, trying to actually jump up and block it. If they're able to, though, the defending team can return the kick. But for kickers, there are advantages. Like, first, the ball is stationary. So it's already being held on the ground, and it doesn't have to be snapped. Second, kickers can run up to the ball rather than take their normal, I think it's two or three steps that they take on field goals. So it's kind of like a kickoff. And then third, the ball is placed on at the spot of the catch. So, you know, if it's punted or there's a kickoff and it goes sky high and the person calls for a fair catch, the field goal kicker will kick it from that spot, not 7 yards further back, like a snapped field goal attempt is. The last successful one of these was a 45-yarder at the end of the first half in 1976. Since then, there have only been 8 attempts, and they're all at the end of the first half. That's when this usually comes into play. So those 8 attempts, they included a Rob Baronis 58-yard miss in 2005, a Neil Racker's 68-yard miss in 2008, Mason Crosby's 69-yard miss in 2008, and most recently, a Phil Dawson 71-yard miss in 2013. And an extra little tidbit that I found interesting, I was reading about, is that the Patriots declined to attempt a 75-yard fair catch kick with 3 seconds left in Super Bowl 51. That's the one, the Super Bowl, they came back from 25 down to beat the Falcons. So at the end of that game, they could have, you know, kicked a 75-yard field goal if they had wanted to, or 75-yard fair catch field goal, but instead they just took the knee and won the game in overtime. The second obscure rule I wanted to talk about was drop kicks, and you guys are probably aware of this one. So on extra points and field goals, players can opt to drop the ball so it hits the ground before kicking it through the uprights. There's, you know, really no benefit to kicking this way, so it's kind of a novelty stunt more than anything else. And since the 1940s, only Doug Flutie converted a drop kick in a meaningless Week 17 game for the Patriots back in 2005. Drew Brees tried once and kicked it into his offensive line, but that was in the 2012 Pro Bowl, so not like it actually matters. Like I said, novelty stunt. And then the third obscure rule I wanted to get to was out-of-bounds kicks. And Ty Montgomery of the Green Bay Packers has been taking advantage of this rule's loophole in recent seasons. So only on kickoffs, if a player ruled out of bounds touches the ball before it's in the end zone, the ball is advanced to the 40-yard line. So when a kick is rolling and close to out of bounds, Mr. Ty Montgomery of the Green Bay Packers, being the smart man that he is, will lay down on the ground with his feet out of bounds, and then he reaches out and touches the football. That's all he has to do. Since he's technically out of bounds, the Packers start with the ball on the 40 instead of the 25. It's brilliant, and a lot of the times this happens, like, the ball will be sitting there, you know, inside the 5-yard line. It's just right there on the edge of the field, and he'll just lie down, put his feet out, and then touch the ball, and boom, they get to advance it to the 40-yard line. 15 extra yards than they normally would. So I'm guessing the NFL is going to probably tie up that loophole at some point. But there you go. There are 3 obscure NFL rules.